إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن خير الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who is truly worthy of all praise. To Allah belongs the most beautiful names. And Allah has attributes of complete perfection. And Allah is one and alone in all of these. And indeed, all thanks is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who is the source of all blessings. And peace and salutations upon the Messenger of Allah, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent as a mercy to all of the alameen. Dear brothers and sisters, we're now at the beginning of the Battle of Badr. The armies are in their places ready, and their swords are unsheathed, and blood is dripping. This ma'araka, of this battle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intended with this to distinguish the truth from the false. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used all the strategies that were available to him in war. But his reliance is upon Allah, because Allah through this battle will establish the truth. What is noted in this battle is that when the Prophet ﷺ fought this battle, he fought it in an arrangement which then fashioned battle after this. All of the battles that came after this, whoever was fighting, used this method to fight. The traditional method of war at that time was fard al-kar. When you saw the enemy on the battle, you began to give chase. You charged into them without any leadership, without any direction, without any arrangement. If your initial challenge failed, you retreated, regrouped, and charged the enemy again. But the Prophet ﷺ, when he fought this battle, he fought it with strategy. He ranged his army in rows. This was unheard of before. He had archers standing in the first row. Nobody would advance and charge back at the army that was advancing, because Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam had ordered so. So you see then, there is a control center and there is an arrangement. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he ordered this fighting, where did the order come from? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الَّذِينَ يُقَاتِلُونَ فِي سَبِيلِهِ صَفًّا. Allah loves those who fight the path of Allah in rows. What are those rows like? Allah describes them, كَأَنَّهُمْ بُنْيَانٌ مَرْصُوصٌ, as if they are a solid wall. This was the fashion of war at the time of Badr. Unknown and unheard of before this. Brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala established the truth. He established the legitimacy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his message in this battle, in such a way that it will then inspire awe in the enemies of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you look, there are two things which we see in this. The first thing is the awe that was inspired by this fashion of war. That you see a wall in front of you. You are chasing into a wall, or charging into a wall. A wall which will not give way. That in itself created fear. This fashion of war wasn't known before. The second thing, that there is qiyada. There is somebody who is instigating this war in a particular arrangement. Brothers and sisters, all of those who later on examine this war, of those people who study strategy in war, they marveled at the perfect method that the Prophet ﷺ used in war. And later on it became a textbook. A textbook method of fighting. Also in the battle of Badr, the Prophet ﷺ has given specific orders. And these orders must be obeyed. First thing is that the archers are in the front row. They are not to charge, they are not to move from their place. Nobody is to fire an arrow until the order is given. We have seen and heard when battles are shown that the leader says, don't fire until you see the whites of their eyes. The Prophet orders this. Why? Do you think there is an unlimited supply of arrows that we can afford to miss? No, there is an army that outnumbers the Prophet and his companions 3 times. They are better equipped. Not a single arrow can go to waste. So the Rumah, the archers, they are waiting until the enemy is close enough that each arrow has the possibility to reach. And when it is an arrow which is guided by Allah, the arrow will not reach its hadaf. And also the Prophet, as I mentioned before, he said to them to make iqtisad in the use of their arrows. وَاسْتَبْقُوا نَبْلَكُمْ. Don't waste your arrows. Each arrow must reach its hadaf, its goal. And of course, as we mentioned before, the Prophet said, "Indan al-qawm minkum fandahuhum bin nubal." If your enemy begins to come close to you, then start to pelt them with arrows. Fire at them arrows. This is the order of the Prophet sallallahu. Do you think this battle was fought without any thought? We rely totally upon Allah. Allah will give them victory. That is assured. Look at the method of the Prophet ﷺ in war. And also the Prophet ﷺ forbid that anybody should unsheathe the sword and then charge into the army. They are all now waiting for the Qaid to order. And then they will go into the battle. Nowadays we find this is one thing that the Muslims have certainly lost. And that is to follow a leader. Any matter, forget about the dawla. In any issue where there is a man who is placed in front of you or above you, we have to obey him. In those matters which he has been appointed for us, we have to obey him in those matters. But you know what we have today? Too many chiefs and no Indians. Everybody wants to be the man in charge. The Qaid, if he is being put there because of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordaining that, and he didn't have any wish for that, then Allah will guide him. Your responsibility is to follow him and listen to him. The companions waited. Waited in the way that the Prophet ﷺ would order them to wait. And you know, subhanAllah, when the battle started, the Prophet ﷺ used everything that was possibly in his advantage. So when he faced the enemy, He turned his back on the rising sun. So when the sun rose, whose eyes were affected by the sun? The mushrikeen. These are all natural methods. Any method that you can use to put the advantage on your side. And of course, one of the most important things in battle is that the army, all of the army, is obedient to the leader. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he came out to inspect the companions on the morning of the battle, you see how they stood in rows. Nowadays we tell people, stand in your rows, train your rows, fill the gaps. Everybody has something to say about it. But there's an interesting incident which I wanted to mention. Sawad ibn Ghaziyah, one of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ, who was standing in the rows. The Prophet ﷺ came to inspect the rows and he had with him an arrow without the sheaths on the end. And he was directing the companions and straightening their rows. And this particular companion was standing out of the row. And the Prophet was saying to them, "Istawu." But this companion wasn't moving. So the Prophet took his arrow and he prodded this companion in his stomach. First of all, strange that one of the companions is ordered by the Prophet and he doesn't listen. This is not acceptable. It can't be. We cannot accept that he's a companion of the Prophet and didn't listen. So there is some sin. There is something which is behind it. There is a reason which you are going to soon learn. So when the Prophet prodded him with this, and he said to him, "Istaqti." The companion, the Prophet, the companion of the Prophet, when he was prodded with this, he said, "Wajati ya Rasulullah. You prodded me and you heard me, O Messenger of Allah. So I want now qisas from you." SubhanAllah. Jundi, who is the lowest of the ranks of in any army, and then he wants qisas from the leader. For what? For disobedience that was in him. When the Prophet prodded him, he said, "O Messenger of Allah, you have hurt me. Now I want my recompense." Nowadays, what would the leader of any army do? He would be court-martialed. He would be given some severe punishment for being disobedient. So the Prophet said, what did he do? He lifted his clothes from his stomach. He said, "Istaqbi. Do whatever you need to do. You prod me the same way that I prodded you." Unheard of today. But look at the time of the Prophet. So then this companion, when he had his opportunity to prod the Prophet, did he prod the Prophet? No, he didn't. He came to the Prophet ﷺ and he touched his stomach. And he kissed his stomach. And when he did this, the Prophet ﷺ said, "Ma hamlaka ala hadha ya such and such, why did you do this?" He said, "O Messenger of Allah, hadhara ma tara, fa'aradtu an yakuna akhir al-ahd bidhalik, an yamussu basharati basharati." He said, "O Messenger of Allah, you can see in front of us that the armies are here now gathered and war is about to begin. So I wanted to make the last thing that I ever did so to touch you, your skin with my skin." The companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we find in them this unique quality. Their love of the Qa'id. He didn't ask because he wanted to harm the Prophet, but because he loved the Prophet and he wanted that to be the last thing that he remembered before he died in the Battle of Badr. There are some points which are very valid in this. First of all, Hirsul Islam ala Nizam.
It's very hard to say that today. How Islam loves organization. When we see that there is nobody more disarrayed than the Muslims. The second thing, Al-Adl al-Mutlaq. Again, a very, very difficult pill to swallow, considering the state of the Muslims today. We are the people of justice. But subhanAllah, today, you will see that the most oppression is in the Muslims. حب الجند لقائده. We've seen that. How the companions, the army of the Prophet Muhammad, they loved him. We will see examples, great examples of sacrifice. How the companions sacrificed themselves and their bodies, putting themselves as human shields in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in other battles. The fourth, تذكرت الموت والشهادة. Islam encourages us to remember our death. And the way we behave is if we're never going to die and never going to return to Allah and never be asked. Strange, isn't it, that we are people who know that this will come to pass, but our actions and our behavior belie that. And also, shahada. Ash-shahadatu fi sabilillah. This is one of those precious things that every Muslim should want to find in his life. Ash-shahadatu fi sabilillah. To die in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet said that there is only a munafiq who will not desire to die in the path of Allah as a martyr. The fifth thing, the body of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is blessed, mubarak. Touching it is barakah. Walidhalik, we find that Sawad, he wanted to touch the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he kissed him on his stomach. And finally, the sixth thing, and this is in Ahkam Fiqhiyya, that it is lawful for a person to expose their stomach, and it is not from the awrah. If it had been from the awrah, the Prophet would have exposed his stomach. So these are some of the benefits that we can draw from what we've heard today so far. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, before he even engaged the mushrikeen in the battle, he engaged the Muslims and encouraged them to fight. And this is very important. That if you have an army that is morally not ready to fight, the morale is low, and they don't have in them this hamas to fight, they will not be good soldiers. So the Prophet is ordered to make the harir, to encourage them to fight. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in Surah Al-Anfal, verse 16, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu harridh al-mu'minina al-qital. Allah is ordering the Prophet, Ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu, O Prophet, harridh al-mu'minina al-qital. Encourage the believers to fight. And of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them a khashiyah at that time, which we don't find in the Muslims today and we will never find. And this is the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, إِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ إِشْرُونَ صَعْبِرُونَ يَغْلِبُونَ مِيَتَيْنَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala promised them that if there are 20 amongst you, believers, you will overcome 200. 10 to 1. The companions stand against the mushrikeen, and Allah is promising them they are 10 to 1. One mu'min against 10 kuffar. Why? Because of their iman. Because of their iman. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells them, وَإِنْ يَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ مِئَةٌ يغلبون ألف ألفا. That if there are amongst you 100, you will overcome 1,000. من الذين كفروا. From those who disbelieve. بينهم قوم لا يفقهون. Because there are people who do not understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has told them, 100 of you is sufficient for 1,000 of them. But the Muslims are 300. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged, raised the morale of the Muslims by promising them, "Umu ila jannati." Allah samawat wa ta'ala. Stand. Make ready for this Jannah which its expanse is greater than the distance between the earth and the heavens. It's waiting for the believers. Allah's Messenger is encouraging them that if you die, then you will go to Jannah. And of course, if you get victory, then you get victory. It's a win-win situation. SubhanAllah. One example of the companions in this matter is Umayr ibn Hammam al-Ansari. When the Prophet told him this, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, Jannatun Ardhuha as-samawati wal-ard." If we fight, we will have Jannah. Its expanse is wider than the distance between the heavens and the earth. So the Prophet said, "Now, yes." So he said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, oh, so he didn't say it to the Prophet, he said the statement, "Bakhil bakhil," which is a statement of maybe disgust, something is not good. So the Prophet asked him, "Ma hamalaka ala hadha al-qawl, bakhil bakhil? What caused you to say this statement?" He said, "La wallahi ya Rasulullah, illa raja'an an akuna min ahliha." He said, "O Messenger of Allah, I didn't intend anything bad by it, except that I hope that I will be from the dwellers of the paradise." What did the Prophet say? He said, "Qala fa'innaka min ahliya." Verily, you are from its dwellers. You are from the people of paradise. Wahi comes to the Prophet and tells him that this man is from the Al-Jannah. But not only that, look at the actions of these people. The actions of these people, inshallah, they're an indication of that thing. What are our actions an indication of? This is why we need to rectify our actions. And this companion took out some dates to eat these dates. Don't forget, they have marched quite a long distance. And much of the distance they have marched on foot, in the heat, in the desert. Very little zaad, very little provisions. So he began to eat. And then he said, "لَئِنْ أَنَا أُحْيَيْتُ حَتَّى أَأْكُلُ تَمَرَاتِ هَذِي إِنَّهَا لَحَيَاةٌ طَوِيلَةٌ." If I were to wait the time to eat these dates, then that is too long to wait. It's too long to wait. So he threw them away. All of the dates again, he threw them away, and he began to fight until he was killed. These are small glimpses to the lives of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how brave they were. Their bravery was in the right place. You know, we find ourselves, we are very brave with our wives and our children. So we come into our home and the wife is cowering because maybe the dinner is not quite on time, and the children begin to run to their rooms because father's home and probably had a hard day at work and they shout at us as usual fashion. We're so brave. Shouldn't we be the mercy that comes into the house? Your wife should greet you with a smile and be happy to see you, because she knows that only good will come from you. Your children should cling onto you and hug you. Our father is home, because you will be kindness and mercy to them. But instead, what do we find now? As soon as the father steps through the door, the children hide in their rooms. much, there is much food for thought for all of us. You know, subhanAllah, I always remember to say this to the brothers when I talk about these issues. Why is it that when our children annoy us, the only words we can say is la'na and salt? Why don't we say Allah yahdik, Allah yuslihk? Why do we say du'as which will rectify us? It's strange that we invoke Allah's curse upon our own children. Al-Muhim, the battle of Badr is now about to begin, and or has begun. And there are many examples of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions of bravery, which you're going to hear, inshallah, in the next week. But there is something we should know. All the strategies that the Prophet did, there is something that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did before all of these strategies, and that was his tawakkul and reliance upon Allah and his du'a for madad from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you find the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that before even the battle began, he gave the believers a bashar. The night he saw a dream in which he saw that the enemy were only a few in number. They were only a few in number. Whereas in reality they were many. But Allah showed him in the dream that there were only a few. So when the Prophet woke up, he told his companions that. So they found what? And that also encouragement. And they made ta'wil of this, that Allah will give us victory. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood. And he began to make dua. He began to make istighatha to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the Quran, إِذْ تَسْتَغِيثُونَ رَبَّكُمْ فَاسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ أَنِّي مُمِدُّكُمْ بِأَلْفٍ مِنَ الْمَلَائِكَةِ مُرْدِفِينَ. SubhanAllah. You know, if you look at the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the things that is most apparent is his connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. After all of those things, the Prophet of making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for victory. And we're going to speak a bit more about this. But subhanAllah, after he made this dua, he said to Abu Bakr, Abshir ya Abu Bakr. Abu Bakr, have glad tidings. And he told the companions that they will have victory. He says to his companions, radiallahu anhum, وَلَذِي نَفْسُ مُحَمَّدٍ بِيَدِهِ لَا يُقَاتِمُنُ الْيَوْمُ رَجُلٌ فَيُقْتَلْ صَابِرًا مُحْتَسِبًا مُقْبِلًا غَيْرَ مُقْبِلٍ إِلَّا أَدْخَلَهُ اللَّهُ جَنَّةً. Those companions were told, any one of you who will fight. And first of all, the Prophet made an oath. He said, I swear by that one in whose hand is the life of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that there is not one from amongst you who will fight. And he will not be fleeing, but he will be running towards the enemy, and he will be killed except that he will enter into Jannah. Bashara upon bashara. There is absolutely no loss. And Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the suhoof, the Muslims, is ready. They're ready, waiting for the order of the Prophet ﷺ to reach them. And we will have to wait till next week to hear what happened in the battle of Badr. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us a people who hear the truth, recognize the truth, and give us the ability to act, and also make us a people who hear the false and recognize people that and give us the ability to avoid it by Aqulu ma tasma'un. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والبشير النذير فإن الله سبحانه وتعالى قد أمركم بذلك في كتابه فقال إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما وقال صلى الله عليه وسلم من صلى علي مرة واحدة صلى الله عليه بها عشر اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وارض الله عن أربعة الخلفاء الراشدين المهديين أبي بكر وعمر وعثمان وعلي وعن أصحابي أجمعين وعن أهل بيت الطيبين الطاهرين وارض اللهم عنا معهم بمنك وكرمك وجودك يا أرحم الراحمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين اللهم أعز الإسلام والمسلمين وأذل الشرك والمشركين ودمر أعداء الدين واحمي حوزة الإسلام يا رب العالمين اللهم اغفر للمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات عباد الله رحمكم الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون اذكروا الله الذي يذكركم وادعوه يستجيب لكم ولذكر الله أكبر والله يعلم ما تصنعون وأقول